krijgen nog wel eens het terechte verwijt dat er geen vrouwen in Wintergast te gast zijn. Ik ben hier in Chicago en het goede nieuws is dat we eindelijk een vrouwelijke gast hebben gevonden. Het slechte nieuws is dat het vroeger een man was, maar we gaan duidelijk vooruit.
What is the best piece of advice you've ever been given, and how has it impacted your personal or professional lives?
What did I tell you that impressed you the most?
Actually, I can answer that. When first I met Warren, we were talking about getting together and doing something again, and he pulled out his calendar, and the pages were so blank.
Waarom werkt het volk hier? En niet met veld, zoals het hoort. De regent. De regent! Heeft hij recht op extra werkdagen?
Nee, dat niet.
Maak er een eind aan. Nou. Goed. Zelf. Tellen. Meneer.
Deirdre McCloskey. Zij is professor in economische geschiedenis in Chicago. Zij is behoorlijk enthousiast over Nederland en de handelsgeest van Nederland. Zij is nog enthousiaster over het kapitalisme en dat allemaal in deze toch behoorlijk zware tijden. Ik ga heel graag met haar praten. Deirdre McCloskey.
Deirdre, thank you very much for letting us into the house of your mother. To be exact, and I also have to point out she's sitting right next to us, so I won't be my normal self because I know she told me she's going to attack me. Before we start with the first clip, I have to point out to the viewer that there are a couple of clips from Holland, and that's not because you want to be nice or polite to the viewers in Holland, but that's because you have like a special relationship with Holland. You study yeah. there, you live there. And a lot of your work is about Holland.
Echt waar?
Yeah, it seems as if you were very fond also of the Dutch people.
Yeah, well, they're openhartig in the strange meaning that word has in Dutch, and they're very bourgeois. you all, whether you like it or not, you Dutch people are middle class. So you should just relax and enjoy it.
And at the end of this interview, they will understand this was not an insult, but in your view, this is a...
Au contraire, as they say in France.
Very good. Let's go to the first clip. The first clip is based on the famous painting by Johannes Vermeer, mm-hmm. A girl with a pearl earring. Let's have a look first.
You're not the first to forget your manners in front of his paintings. Tell me, girl, do you think it finished? 3 months, another 3 before he's satisfied, no doubt. Well, get along, girl. You're not paid to stand gawping all day.
Here's my mum.
How? This is Greet, the new maid. She'll fetch the meat now.
So, Greet, what takes your fancy? Nothing's too good for this family.
An ox tongue and a dozen chops.
Peter! Chops! In the book, again. There you are.
This meat's not fresh. The mistress won't like it.
Peter! Get the parcel on the cart.
That's better.
We'll see you again, Greet.
bankrupt. I've lived next door for as long as I can remember. The shame. Lost everything. Watch out for young mistress. She hates money troubles. She'll turn spiteful at this, you mark my words.
You're being ridiculous. I'm going out.
No, John. Don't you dare leave.
1 year it got so bad, they had to sell some of her jewels. You can imagine how that pleased her. She smashed half the china. Went to spoil one of his precious paintings. Well, he's a temper on him too, for all he's so quiet.
This is the Dutch bourgeoisie. What's so important about the Dutch bourgeoisie?
Well, there are all kinds of things that come out in these scenes. For one thing, in 1630 or so, when this is supposed to be happening, it's clear that Holland, even in the special sense, in Delft, is a class society. So you have the rich and the poor, so there's no question there. But everyone's a makelaar. Everyone's a merchant. That Vermeer spends 6 months in a painting is, I think, meant to express that, well, he's not a makelaar. He's outside. He's an artist in the modern sense. But I doubt very much that he thought of himself that way. Because painters in those days didn't think of themselves as romantic artists. They were in business. And although he produced very few paintings, they sold. He was, you know, he was not a rich man, but he made a fair amount of money that way. There are all kinds of things that are going on in this scene. The challenge that she makes about the freshness of the meat is portraying the filmmaker and the novelist are portraying the cheating side of capitalism. But of course, she's meant to be a reasonably sophisticated, if a working class person, and she's Dutch. She's Dutch. She's not gonna be cheated.
Okay, and that's also the typically Dutch part of it. That they're all in business.
What's strange though is that the Dutch language, in common with other Germanic languages, hasn't got a word for prudence, in exactly the sense that I use it in my books, and that Aristotle uses it in the sense of phronesis, practical knowledge.
Could you define prudence then? Because it's really interesting, because I read your books and the word prudence came back all the time, and I've been looking for a Dutch word.
You can't.
And now you tell me.
You won't find it, because in Dutch you have a spar, saving, yeah. You know, being cautious. And that's one part of prudence. You got to be cautious. You don't walk off the building. But it means practical knowledge, know-how. Savoir faire in the French phrase, and she has it, and the butcher, the seller of the meat, has it, and the young man who's going to be her, they're going to fall in love, he has it, and the woman in the original scene with the big ruff, well, that's very expensive. Lace was very expensive, and she shows that she's rich. She's the mother. She shows that she's rich by having a ruff, and that she's bourgeois in the particular sense of a rich burgher. Yeah. But she too is about prudence. Everyone in Dutch society was about prudence.
And you're implying that we're still like that. We're still a bourgeois society,
yes.
Based on these principles.
As Huizinga in the 1930s famously said, We Dutch are bourgeois. We always have been. It's the practical problems of living on a mud flat at the mouth of the Rhine and the Maas. You know, you had to, there's this famous business about cooperation among the Dutch. This marvelous poem in the 1930s, I'm thinking of Holland is the English translation.
Ah, yeah.
And at the end, Holland. The yeah. Stem van den van de water, the terror of the water, that's made them people cooperative, but it's cooperative in a deal-making capitalist bourgeois way, which was such a contrast to the Spanish and even the English at the time. The English eventually became Dutch. That late 17th century, they got a Dutch king having fought three wars against the Dutch.
Let's go to the next clip, because yeah. that's a clip of the movie King Henry V, yeah. based on the play
contrast.
By Shakespeare.
Yep.
They're going to fight with the French,
yeah,
as usual.
This is in 1415.
Yeah, and the scene we're going to see is that the king delivers a speech just before the Battle of Agincourt. It's funny to point out, I think, that the English government paid for this, or the British government
sure.
paid for this, because they thought it was really good for the morale of the British troops.
It was in the war.
Yeah.
Where is the king?
The king himself is rode to view their battle.
The fighting men, they have full 70,000.
There's 5-1. Besides, they all are fresh.
God's arm strike with us is a fearful odds.
Well, God with you, princes, all are to my charge. If we no more meet till we meet in heaven, then joyfully, my noble Westmoreland, my dear Lord Gloucester, my good Lord Exeter, and my kind kinsmen, warriors all, adieu.
Farewell, good soul, Brett. And good luck go with thee.
Farewell, kind lord.
Oh, that we now had here but 10,000 of those men in England that do not work today.
What's he that wishes so? My cousin Westmoreland? No, my fair cousin. If we are marked to die, we are enough to do our country loss. And if to live, the fewer men, the greater share of honor. God's will, I pray thee, wish not one man more. Rather proclaim it, Westmoreland, through my host, that he which hath no stomach to this feast, let him depart. His passport shall be drawn, and crowns for convoy put into his purse. We would not die in that man's company that fears his fellowship to die with us. This day is called the Feast of Crispian. He that outlives this day and comes safe home will stand a tiptoe when this day is named and rouse him at the name of Crispian. He that shall live this day and see old age will yearly on the vigil feast his neighbors and say, tomorrow is St. Crispian. Then will he strip his sleeve and show his scars and say, these wounds I had on Crispin's day. Old men forget, yet all shall be forgot, but he'll remember with advantages what feats he did that day. Then shall our names, familiar in his mouth as household words, Harry the King, Bedford and Exeter, Warwick and Talbot, Salisbury and Gloucester, be in their flowing cups freshly remembered. This story shall the good man teach his son. And Crispin Crispian shall ne'er go by from this day to the ending of the world, but we in it shall be remembered. We few, we happy few, we band
of brothers.
For he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother, be he ne'er so base. And gentlemen in England now abed
shall think themselves accursed
they were not here, and hold their manhoods cheap. While any speak that fought
with us
upon St. Crispin's Day.
Wow.
Oh, that's one of the great speeches.
You get all excited.
Oh, I get all excited because it appeals to a permanent feature of human character, which is to admire courage and to have loyalties. You can call it faith. I not only love Holland, I love England too. And so this English nationalism, which Shakespeare was stirring up in this, against the terrible French, is something that always appeals to us. It's our tribal character as human beings. But it's, of course, a great contrast to the bourgeois virtues, as I call them, which are the virtues of courage and faith and love and temperance and blah, blah, all the others in a commercial framework. Okay, and that's the contrast. This is a battlefield. The only source of honor in Shakespeare is war or being a member of a court, which is a kind of reflection of war. Whereas the source of honor, and this was what was so peculiar about Holland, the source of honor among the Dutch was making money. Not necessarily cheating people, the earlier piece suggested that's how you do it, but making deals, agreeing to what I call the bourgeois deal. You let me engage in creative destruction, allow the people to go bankrupt, as the next door neighbor did in the previous clip, and as is going to happen in the next clip, and allow creative destruction.
Maybe you should explain creative destruction.
No, it simply means you think up a better way of doing things. Walmart is one of my favorite examples, as it is my mother's. The Dutch invented a float, the ship with a flat bottom and a small crew, and then they kind of took their chances on piracy and went into the Baltic and started enormous trade from the Baltic. They drained upholders with, you know, scores, 100 windmills. They thought up the VOC, you know, let's form a company and go to Indonesia. And these innovations bankrupted other people. They always do. Actually, my favorite example of this comes from jazz. Charlie Parker, after the Second World War, made unemployed a lot of swing jazz musicians. Very sweet, wonderful stuff. Yeah. But Charlie Parker, with his fast playing and wow, that became the way to do jazz. So in the arts, in intellectual life, right, you aren't going to improve economics unless it gets beyond the Samuelsonian framework it now has, which was invented by a man named Paul Samuelson. And in order for this science to advance to what I call a humanomics, it's got to not completely destroy the previous stuff. Charlie Parker used some harmonies that had been used by the swing musicians, but it makes their work less valuable.
Okay, but you don't destruct just for the sake of destruction.
That's the trouble. If you have a zero-sum idea about the economy, that one merchant gets better off because another merchant is made worse off, and the customers are not helped by this, which is how people think of Walmart, that's wrong. What happens is that the customers are made better off by the cheaper goods that a company like Walmart can provide. It hasn't expanded much in Europe. Or Aldi. Aldi is a good example in Germany. So it's to the advantage of us as consumers that all these other people are competing. But they're competing to do a good job for us. And this is true in novels and poetry, well, less so in modern poetry than it should be, but in the arts, in filmmaking, in TV
And the Dutch were particularly good at it.
They were very good at it. They were the largest middle class society in history. Holland became the great model in Adam Smith by the end of the 18th century. Adam Smith is praising Holland all the time as what we can expect if we Scottish people behave well. Yeah. We'll get to be Dutch.
It's so funny to come all the way to Chicago and hear how Holland have been doing it. That's really great. Now I think we're going to something, a lot of people are not that proud of. We're going to Max Havelaar, the movie based on the famous book by Milton Tully. A Dutch officer gets a job in Indonesia, and he takes his oath to protect the local people very serious. Let's take a look.
Waarom werkt het volk hier? En niet met veld, zoals het hoort?
De regent.
De regent! Heeft die recht op extra werkdagen?
Nee, dat niet.
Maak er een eind aan. Nou. Goed. Doe het zelf. Tellen. Meneer.
Aspera.
Meneer, wacht! Alsjeblieft, kalm. Doe het toch kalm aan met de regent. Waarom is het volk?
Mengapa begitu? Banyak rakyat memotong rumput. Siapa yang memerintahkan tanpa izin saya?
Saya yang memerintahkan. Dari dulu sudah begitu.
Maar meneer Havelaar, alle vorige assistent-residenten hebben het toegelaten.
Tuan tidak berhak memotong rumput di kebun Tuan. Karena itu, sama-sama terlantar. Dan karena itu, ada kelebaran di lebak. Saya minta Tuan menyuruh pulang orang-orang itu.
Baik. Saya menyuruh mereka pulang. Tapi sekarang sudah sore. Kalau saya suruh mereka pulang sekarang, mereka toh tidak bisa bekerja lagi di rumah. Apakah mereka boleh menyelesaikan pekerjaannya?
Stuurt u die mensen even weg.
Ya, Michael.
Stuur ze weg! Ik wacht op wat u doet. Tuan assistent resident menanyakan saya untuk menyampaikan sesuatu yang penting. Tuan assistent resident mengatakan bahwa kalian itu tidak usah melakukan pekerjaan ini untuk bupati. Karena itu kalian boleh pulang.
To go into another country and raise taxes and steal their all kinds of spices and sell them in the, on the...
Well, but you see, that's what happened. The VOC went bankrupt, as eventually the English East India Company did not too long afterwards. And then you got the Raj, as they called it in India. And it was worse. It was worse than the VOC. Because it was a government, and indeed a substantial part of the budget of the Dutch government, the central government, in the late 19th century, came from extractions from Indonesia, whereas the VOC, you know, hadn't been able to find out how to extract enough to keep going. You see what I mean?
I see what you mean, but are you implying that it wasn't profitable to
it
go?
It wasn't profitable. That's why it went bankrupt. I mean, that, you know, the one theme that's in all these clips is bankruptcy. Is this is non-creative destruction. Well, in a way, it's part of creative destruction because, for example, some of the spices that the Dutch had a monopoly on started to be grown, say, in Africa. And this was This was catastrophe. This was not a good thing for the Dutch East India Company. So the price of ginger and so on fell below what it was before. And so this wonderful buying low and selling high wasn't as low or as high, especially not as high as it was. So they failed, but that, of course, was good for consumers worldwide. They were made better off by the failure, so to speak, by the failure of the Dutch East India Company. Then it got taken over as kind of a, well, we have an empire, kind of, that we got from this commercial operation. Let's keep it, and then it becomes compulsion. It becomes more violent, strangely. And this is what the Dutch became so guilty about with the publication of Max Havelaar, which had a very similar effect as has Uncle Tom's Cabin in the United States, which was the anti-slavery book that Abraham Lincoln said about the author, well, you're the little lady who started this big war, said he. And
but the feelings of guilt, they're justified, they're not.
They are by the end of the 19th century, they are. By the 19th century, it got mixed in with racism, with this idea that, people have histories, and we white people, you know, the people who turned left and then left again when they left Africa, we're all Africans. Anyway, people like me and you, we are superior. And, you know, this, as you know, this was at its height around 1900.
Yes.
Take up the white man's burden, said Kipling. But, and actually, he was right. It was a burden.
Yeah, because you're implying that imperialism, it didn't work.
It was a disaster.
It was a disaster.
The idea that people are rich in Holland now, or were rich in Holland in 1900, because they exploited people of color, is ridiculous.
But what did they do? But they went in to become rich.
I know.
So the mistake they made?
That means individual people became rich. Max Havelaar's colleagues became rich, but that was a tiny group, and although it made ordinary Dutch people feel very glorious that they had an empire, which they lost in 1949 after some very nasty attempts to hold on to it, it wasn't what made people rich. What made people rich was this creative destruction. What made people rich is that the Dutch showed up on time for work, and they worked hard, and they worked smart. Now, here's what the average Dutch / British person earned in 1800. Hear this, $6 a day, 4 or 5 euros a day for everything, food, education, trips to wonderful Chicago, which you should all come to, by the way, for a holiday. That was $6 a day was going to cover it all. Now, how much do you think the average Dutch person earns? About $100 a day. From 6 to 100. And the stuff is better. We have antibiotics. You went to a doctor in 1800, it's as much as, you know, you were going to be killed by the doctor. You were going to be bled and crazy things like that. Yeah. You went to an economist someone about the economy in 1800, and they didn't know what they were talking about. Both of those have gotten better since then. And so even poor people are much better off in Holland than they were in 1800.
I mean, that's not because we stole all
the stuff. All the stuff, and there's a very widespread opinion among educated people in the West that they're rich because they're exploiting the third world, or whatever we call it. And that's just nonsense. We trade mainly with other rich people. it's better for us that China and India are now growing at these fantastic rates. Making the whole world bourgeois is what's going to make us all not just better off materially, but also spiritually. We're, in 50 years, even Africa will be a bourgeois place mainly. And we'll, and with their great opportunities in varied gene pools, much more varied than the rest of the world, they're going to do very well.
Great. So it's going in the right direction.
It's going in the right direction, and especially in the last half century. But it started about two centuries ago. It's completely unprecedented. It never happened. It didn't happen in the Chinese Empire, which was very ingenious and invented a lot of things, paper and gunpowder. It didn't happen in Spain at its height or the Roman Empire or any of that. It happened in Amsterdam and Leiden. In Utrecht, and then in London, and Glasgow, and Manchester.
Yeah, that we cut that out. We just want to have the Dutch.
Is he doing okay, Mama?
I'm okay.
Yeah, good. Let's go to something special now for Wintergast, because normally you have clips of movies or television programs, but you you asked specifically for a picture.
Yeah.
And it's a picture of South Korea and North Korea.
Yeah, that's a good one.
It's a satellite picture.
There you are.
Made by night. North Korea is saving on energy, I think. So that's the only conclusion I could draw.
Well,
what are we seeing?
Their income per head is about $6 a day. So to understand how bad things were in 1800, even in the prosperous Amsterdam, Leiden, Utrecht, you have to think of how things are going now in North Korea.
Yeah.
And then you look at South Korea. In 1953, after the Korean War, North and South Korea had both the same income, and it was about the same income as Somalia now. They were flat on their back. They had had a war raging up and down their country. They weren't very prosperous before. And then the South Koreans adopted the bourgeois deal. They adopted, we can call it capitalism, although I think the very word is somewhat misleading, because it seems to focus on the money, or the piles of bricks, or the piles of university degrees.
So how would you define it then? What?
Innovation, allowing people to do things new ways, to improve their TV cameras so they're not, you know, the way they were in the 50s, they were enormous, to improve the sound things, to do, and then South Korea adopted all these things from the West and made it easy, and from Japan across the Sea of Japan, and North Korea, you can see, didn't. You can see the same contrast, it's not as sharp, in El Paso, in Texas. I've been there. And at night, you look at El Paso. You can stand on a hill and look at El Paso, and you look across to the Mexican town. And the Mexican town is darker. It's not as dark as that. If you didn't have the lines to show you where the country start, you would think that South Korea was an island. I mean, yeah. It must be another island in the Sea of Japan, like Hokkaido. So this is the contrast.
And it's all because of innovation.
Absolutely, it's because of allowing people to. Of course, it's also, by the way, the obsession of Korean mothers with education. But the North Korean mothers are just as obsessed.
Yeah,
that's a cultural thing, and culture alone, you see, doesn't do it. You have to have two things. You've got to have liberty. That is, you have to be allowed to do this stuff and can't have the government, people coming and asking for bribes to allow you to turn on the electricity, right? And you've got to have dignity for people in business. They have to be admired. And indeed, the coming of what I call the bourgeois virtues, which are just the old virtues in this commercial form, is crucially dependent on treating people with dignity. The class structure that you see in the girl with the pearl earring, or in Henry V, or in Max Havelaar, that's got to go for things to work well. It can't be that a man, as Henry V says, whatever his condition will be gentled, that's the word he is, if he fights with me. Gentled means becoming a gentleman. And that was a completely different class from hoi polloi, ordinary folk. But that changed. So you got this other dimension of dignity.
We have a clip which is too good not to start now. This is from Wall Street, the famous movie 1987 with Michael Douglas, made by Oliver Stone. Right. And this is the famous greed speech.
The new law of evolution in corporate America seems to be survival of the unfittest. Well, in my book, you either do it right or you get eliminated. In the last 7 deals that I've been involved with, there were 2.5 million stockholders who have made a pre-tax profit of $12 billion. Thank you. I am not a destroyer of companies. I am a liberator of them. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. Greed, in all of its forms, greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind, and greed, you mark my words, will not only save Teldar Paper, but that other malfunctioning corporation called the USA. Thank you very much.
It's interesting to point out that a lot of people became stockbrokers because of this speech, because they hated this.
In fact, there was a version of this speech which was actually given not by Michael Douglas, but by a guy who worked in this industry, to Berkeley, the University of California at Berkeley. And when he said something like, "Greed is good," all the kids clapped. Yay! Greed is not good. Greed is prudence, this word that we haven't got a word for in Dutch.
That is a problem for the subtitles now. I don't know
prudence,
what's under me now.
Prudence, it's prudence in the absence of the other virtues. If you have not justice, if you have not love, you are as a clanging gong or a tinkling cymbal, as St. Paul said. If you have not temperance and courage and hope, along with prudence being self-interest, savoir faire, knowing how to do things, then you're just a maximizing machine. People wouldn't think like this. They would think, oh, I want to be a person. And let's see, people, as distinct from animals and plants, well, I'd have to include dogs in people because they're partly people. But cats are not. Cats are just animals.
This is because you have a dog.
I have a dog.
Who's called and William Shakespeare.
I've had cats. Yes, his name is Will Shakespeare. But cats, as anyone who's owned a cat knows, are maximizers. They're completely without any ethics. Whereas a dog gets caught eating the meat for the evening meal. You know, he jumped up and he got it, and he's terribly guilty about it. He goes around saying, "Oh my God, I've been a bad dog. That's how humans are.
And that's also how bankers are.
I have a banker here in my neighborhood in Chicago. His name is Roy Svensson. And he's my ideal of a retail banker. Of course, he's trying to do the prudent thing for his company. He's trying to make money for the company. But he's not doing it by screwing me. I've seen him deal. I'm fairly well to do, but I've seen Roy deal with poor people in his bank, and he treats them with respect. He treats them with dignity, because Roy, like you and me, wants to be a good person. In fact, there's an extremely interesting argument that that some psychologists have made, that what's strange about humans is they're really interested in being good. Hitler thought he was good. He didn't say, "Ah, I'm bad. Oh, how wonderful to be bad." He wasn't Satan. He didn't think he was. He thought he was doing good. The fool. What a terrible mistake. But people want to be good. So
are they good?
Because no, they're not good. They're not good. They're bad. Sometimes it depends on your.
No, I'm saying this because you remember the name of your banker because he's your banker, but also because I don't know if you can name another 10 bankers in the neighborhood.
Well,
who are,
you know, when I deal with my banker in Holland, I'm not so pleased because they're not into, you know, as you know, the banks in Holland are very big and they tend to get a little bit arrogant. You give them your money and suddenly it's their money.
Yeah, but isn't that one of the problems when people say, like, you know, a lot of people who bought houses who didn't have the money for it, they're as greedy and as stupid as those bankers. The only difference with the bankers is the bankers do it not with their own money, with the money of other people.
With impunity, yeah, that's right. I have a friend who bought a house 2005, I think it was, 2006, and he got a mortgage, a loan from a banker without any down payment. You know, and as an economist, I should have said to myself, good Lord, something's wrong with this system that allows draws bankers to slice and dice, as we say, these mortgages. But by the way, I was...
Didn't you say that? Because you just said, as an economist, this is a good system.
I know. Look, here's the key thing about this, the system of market-based innovation, sometimes called capitalism, but I've told you I don't like the word.
Yeah.
It makes mistakes. So does socialism.
Yeah.
So does, I don't know, kingship. So does this, so does that.
Yeah.
All human systems make mistakes. And the mistakes that the system makes is excessive optimism and then waves of excessive pessimism. And that's what we've just gone through. Since 1800, there have been 40 of these episodes. 40. A lot of episodes. And some of them have been as bad as this one. The Great Depression was much worse, but, you know, the 1890s were no black bag of bluebirds, as my mother mysteriously says. So there are these bad episodes, but in all of them, when we came out of them, the income of the average person was higher than it was before because of creative destruction. We overdid the railways. You remember the dot-com boom? We overdid that.
Yeah.
We overdid automobiles. We're foolish humans. We think, you know, people were talking, even some economists, I was appalled, in 2006 and 7, were talking about the business cycle being revoked, it would never happen again, and everything was going to go up, up, up. It made no sense historically. As an economic historian, I know that things go up and down, but they go up like this. They go up, watch my finger. My finger is a scientific instrument. Now watch, it goes like this. As long as it keeps going up in trend, as it has since the year 1800, around 1800, we'd better keep it. I just wrote
The going up has to do with average income.
Yeah.
But there's also the point that income isn't given to all the people in an average way. In America, it's 1%.
1% versus 90%. By the way, I'm in the 99%. Wealthy as I am, look around.
Yeah, but that's most people. Most people.
People,
yeah,
I
okay.
Mean, it's so called 99% for a good reason.
But so the whole idea of average income doesn't say that much, that it goes
up. No, it says a great deal. It says that your ancestors and mine, my Irish, Norwegian, and English peasant ancestors, your Dutch or
Polish
ancestors, yeah. Polish farmers, were miserable in 1800, yeah. And I mean, now you've noticed that neither you and I are miserable, because we're average people. The poorest people in the United States drive cars often. There was a, when The Grapes of Wrath, a great film, came out in the United States, from a great book by Steinbeck came out, the Soviets thought, aha, we can use this to show how terrible conditions are in the United States. And so they played it all over the Soviet Union. I thought, oh boy, this is great. And to their horror, the main message that the Soviet audiences took from it was that they were astonished that the Jode family from Oklahoma fled from starvation in an automobile, whereas they had to walk. What we need is what I call an ethical capitalism. And I've got a kind of self-contradictory way of saying this. I say we need it, which implies we don't have it. But I say, no, wait a second. Yes, we do have it. It's not perfect, but people do act professionally. Humans want to be humans, not rats.
We have to go to the next clip. Well, I could listen to this for more. Let's watch like Warren Buffett and Bill Gates.
Okay.
How do you know that the management one level below you is making decisions that would parallel your own?
We have all the money we need. You know, we'd like to have more, but we can afford to lose money. But we can't afford to lose reputation, not a shred of reputation. And therefore, I ask the managers, I ask them to judge every action they take, not just by legal standards, although obviously that's the first test, but also by the test, what I call the newspaper test. How would they feel about any given action if they knew it was to be written up the next day in their local paper, to be read by their family, by their friends, by their neighbors, written by a smart but kind of unfriendly reporter? And if it passes that test, it's okay. And I tell them if anything is close to the lines, it's out. And they can always call me if they wanted to check something. But if they call me, there's something wrong with it probably anyway. So, and that's about it.
Could you tell us a little bit about your typical workday and how you manage your time to allot for...
I'm in meetings a lot. My calendar gets very full with those. And then at night, after the kids have gone to bed, I'm on email a great deal. I get messages during the day. That's my chance to give long responses. And then over the weekend, I send a lot of mail as well. I take 2 weeks a year to just go off and read and think, where I'm not interrupted by work or anything else. I'm just solidly trying to think about the future, and people get to send me things to read as part of that so-called Think Week. So it's a nice mix of things. About 25% of the time that I'm out traveling around, meeting with customers, Europe, Asia, and that sort of helps me think, okay, do we have the right priorities? What are people responding well to, and what would they like to see us do better?
I'm on Think Week about 50 weeks a year. I work about two. And you'd be surprised at my days. I mean, they're very unstructured. No meetings, none. I mean, I don't like meetings. I read a lot. I wish I were a faster reader. I'd get more done. But I do read a lot, and I'm on the phone a moderate amount. Our businesses run themselves, basically, out there. My job is allocating capital, and that's what I'm thinking about. But I don't like to have things all packed hour to hour to hour. And Bill and I are both extraordinarily lucky. I mean, we really get to do what we like to do, the way we want to do it, with people that we choose to be around, and they're terrific. I mean, we've really got everything our way, and we're very fortunate. And in his world, he has a different kind of pace than I have, but we both love it the way we do it. And my guess is that we're each the most productive in that particular mode too, because it fits our personalities and aptitudes.
What is the best piece of advice you've ever been given, and how has it impacted your personal or professional lives?
What did I tell you that impressed you the most?
Actually, I can answer that. When first I met Warren, we were talking about getting together and doing something again, and he pulled out his calendar, and the pages were so blank. And I said, wow, you know, you've managed to avoid getting tied in to a lot of kind of meaningless activity. And, you know, Warren said, yeah, you have to be good at saying no and picking the things that really make a difference. And that's one of many things I've learned from Warren, but that's one of my favorites. And so I can blame it on him whenever I'm turning things down.
Yeah, well, I told him that was it. The truth is I don't get invited anyplace. So. I think that, you know, I got an awful lot of good advice from my dad, and he didn't lay it on me. I mean, he just, you know, you picked it up from him, but there was never any of this, you know, do this, do that type of thing at all. But I think he really taught me that it's more important in terms of what's on your inner scorecard than your outer scorecard. I mean, some people get in a position where they're thinking all of the time of what the world's going to think of this or that instead of what they themselves think about. And if your inner scorecard, if you're comfortable with that, I think you're going to have a pretty happy life. And I think the people that strive too much for the outer scorecard sometimes find that it's a little hollow when they get all through.
Certainly, Warren Buffett is right that this external scorecard is not, you know, checking off the boxes, Harvard graduate, oh yeah, I got that, Harvard PhD, University of Chicago, got that. That stuff is not in the end what a full human life is about. Warren, I wish I could call him Warren and he were my friend, but he's an excellent example of what I said before. The ethical capitalist. He's actually a banker. That's in essence what he does. And his very clever rule, don't do anything you wouldn't want to see in the newspaper, is sound advice for all of us. And it relates precisely to Adam Smith's famous theory of moral sentiments. Adam Smith wrote another book.
His
first book, the one that made him a European reputation in philosophy, 1759, The Theory of Moral Sentiments. And he spoke of the impartial spectator, the conscience is one word for it, a French word, but it's Warren Buffett's rule. What would the impartial spectator say about my behavior right now? And I think that's the way most people work, unless they've been corrupted by bad advice, so to speak. The student asked, what advice do you give? What's your best advice? And the best advice is, to your own self be true.
Do you consider yourself, do you still consider yourself to be an economist? Because you're so interested in the rest of the world and you're so full of stories and thoughts and...
There's a great American comedian who flourished in the 1930s and 40s on film, Mae West.
I know her.
And she made all kinds of joke. She was an extremely creative person. And she made a joke. She said, I was Snow White, but I drifted. And that hinges on the double meaning of the word drift, which means move away, move around, and also means a snow drift, a pile of snow. I was Snow White, the person in the snow. Okay, and I drifted. Well, that's what I say about me in economics. I'm an economist, but I was Snow White, and I drifted. I'm a professor of history and English and communication in Holland. I was a visiting professor of philosophy, art and cultural studies, and so on and so forth. So, but I think that that's how to be a good economist in every sense of good. Try to have an economics that's about human beings, not about rats.
The next clip is from the movie Transamerica, about a man, I think 2 weeks before he has an operation to become a female, and he just has to talk to his psychiatrist about the last papers to be filled in.
But she, by now, is a woman. Because it's not about operations. It's not et operatie that's at issue here. It's social presentation. And she had been presenting herself as a woman for
months. So she's a woman already. I thought all the time, how I'm going to introduce this, I'm going to get into trouble. This is a movie. I'm just doing it again. This is a clip from a movie.
Any suicidal tendencies?
No.
Have you ever felt as though you were being followed?
No.
Any history of family mental illness?
No.
Medical procedures to date?
The usual electrolysis, 3 years of hormone therapy, facial feminization surgery, brow lift, forehead reduction, jaw recontouring, and a tracheal shave.
You look very authentic.
I try to blend in, keep a low profile. I believe the slang terminology is living stealth.
Do you consider yourself a happy person?
Yes. I mean, no. I mean, I will be.
Miss Osborne, there's no such thing as a right answer in this
office. Bullshit.
Yes. I'm a very happy person.
How can I help you?
Of course, there's a right answer. These psychiatrists are so terrible.
Please?
The American Psychiatric Association categorizes gender dysphoria as a very serious mental disorder.
After my operation, not even a gynecologist will be able to detect anything out of the ordinary about my body. I will be a woman. Don't you find it odd that plastic surgery can cure a mental disorder?
How do you feel about your penis?
It disgusts me. I don't even like looking at it.
What about friends?
They don't like it either.
No, I mean, do you have the support of friends?
I'm very close to my therapist.
What about your family?
My family is dead.
We were watching this and you could hardly contain yourself about the questions. You were not disgusted by your penis.
No, not at all.
So that's the good news.
Yeah.
But is this in any way, you know, I'm not familiar to all these things, but if I watch the movie, is this
accurate?
Is it?
Yeah, it's extremely accurate. I had the same kind of interview actually three times. I'm probably the only person within the range of this show who's been certified sane three times. Because, unhappily, particularly in the United States, there is a very inquisitorial attitude that the psychiatrists have. And alas, recently, this is 2011, the American Psychiatric Institution Association has moved backwards in its treatment of transgendered people. In 1973, they took the diagnosis of homosexuality out of their diagnostic manual. Before, being gay was to be crazy. Now, in 2011, they've made it worse. So they're a dangerous group of people. Because as she points out, I mean, this is silly. What mental disease, I don't know, schizophrenia, can be cured with surgery?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, and it, by the way, it's not et operatsi that's the key here. It's not the plumbing operation. Because how many times do a day do you get inspected for your plumbing? I hope never.
No.
Whereas all day long, people are seeing your face and seeing a male face. So what matters is the facial. These are my cheekbones. I paid for them. This is
how long
my
ago was your operation?
Well, but see, you're focusing on the
no,
operation.
No, I'm asking it because I want to know, because the next question would be, when did you feel like a woman then?
1996 was my operation. It was in Australia.
But before that, you felt like you were a woman?
Oh, yeah, but I didn't pass, and I'm telling you, it's torture not to pass. If people see you as a man in a dress, if women see you as a man in a dress, their reaction is fear, because they think you're crazy or they think you're a man trying to get away with something.
This is what happens to you. So if you walk into the dressing room with
if you were to put on a dress and walk around in Chicago or Amsterdam, you would get a lot of very hostile stares from women. And from men, even in Holland, you would be attacked. I have an acquaintance in Holland who was beaten up 4 times. She's a not very persuasive transgender person, and she was beaten intolerant in Holland.
Yeah, but Holland isn't that tolerant.
Yeah, you all say that, but you're much more tolerant than here.
But what about you? You had many problems, like, you know, I don't want to know if you...
I wasn't beaten up, thank God, but I had problems passing. Finally, the hormones and the operations, the nose, the blah, blah, finally, and I learned gestures. She was very skillfully imitating in that part where she comes out of the house. She was imitating a former man imitating a woman, which is a very skilled piece of acting.
Yeah, yeah.
That's why she was in the running for an Academy Award.
And you learned all kinds of gestures?
Of course.
Who taught you this?
It's pretty easy. You would just watch other women. You watch what they do.
For example, how they pick something up?
Pick something up. I have a friend in Holland, Marianne, who, when we were walking in Rotterdam, there was a kind of a curb, a little stone thing, and I walked over it. And she said, "Oh no, dear, you step onto it and then off it. That's what a girl would do." So from then on, that's what I did. So I had lots of help from people in Holland, mainly from women, and in the United States. Offering me support. My mom, for example, took her 5 minutes to adjust to this. She had no idea that I was this way, but she adjusted and has been a rock of support. But there are certain things you have to do to pass. You can't sit like a man, you can't sit like this and expect to pass. You're just not gonna do very
well. But for whom do you have to pass? Because your friends accept you. But why does it make you
feel? Because it's dangerous to not pass with men, and it's demoralizing to not pass with women. You have no idea. Look.
No, I have no idea, so that's why we don't.
You know, if you were trying to pass as, well, here's an example. People who have problems with hearing, have hearing loss or have always been deaf. In order to just have an ordinary life, they've got to pass for most purposes as hearing. They can't wear a sign around their head, they're themselves deaf, please assume that I can't hear what you're saying. They have to try to do things, and in fact, in the deaf community, they talk like this. They talk about, they're not trying to fool people. This isn't some sort of trick they're trying to perform, but it's just to make your life sort of normal. to not have to be struggling all the time. Oh, wait a second, I'm transgendered. Once having to tell your whole life history every time you talk to a man at the post office.
Yeah.
And this is quite irritating.
That's
a third reason. There's the danger, there's the demoralization, and there's just constant irritation of having to talk about it.
And do you feel comfortable now? Because when you came in, because you seem very comfortable.
Thank you very much, and I do feel comfortable. I feel that I'm who I am, but you know, that's kind of a romantic notion that I'm not entirely comfortable with. We all have male and female inside us. You have your sister and your mother and your aunt inside you and so on. And it can come out, it can be expressed or not.
Yeah.
When I was a guy, I was happy as a guy. I was not a miserable person. I did not feel, as the journalistic summary is always saying, oh, I was a woman in a man's body. What a lot of baloney. It's nonsense, it's silly. That's not how most people feel, most transgender people feel. When I was, you're looking at the captain of her high school football team. I mean American football, where we crash into each other. I can still do.
You still have the pictures in
a pretty good cross body block if I had to.
That would be good.
So as a man, I was a man, and I had no trouble. I'm a father. My children are alienated. They won't talk to me. One is 42. The other is 37.
And they've never talked.
They have never talked to me since I became a woman. I have two grandchildren. They live about half an hour from here, in Chicago, who I've never seen. I'm not permitted to. And indeed, my children, alas, cut off my whole side of the family. They won't talk to my mother or anyone else. It's stupid, I agree. And what makes it worse is not so much my pain as my grandchildren missing having another person who loves them in their life.
Yeah, but
is not so common that we should throw it away with both hands. It's a big mistake. If you're having trouble with your father or something, forgive him and carry on with his love.
But you go over your own pain very easily, not that you have to.
No, I didn't. It took me years. I cried about it for years. But my own pain is not, I'm just saying that's not the only thing. And right now, you know how it is with pain. We all have these stories in our life, not about changing gender necessarily, but, you know, Aunt Louise will say something unkind to Uncle Fred at Thanksgiving 20 years ago, and they'll never talk to each other.
No, but this to have your own children not talk to you anymore.
I know. But it's rather common in life. If you haven't, I'll bet in your own family there are situations like this. It's very common.
Are you a different economist now because you're?
Well, I can't tell. You know, you can't do controlled experiments on your own life. In some ways, this humanomics is a more, you could say, feminine way of looking at economics. Because it's not so, well, you know, I don't want to offend men, but it's not so simple-minded as men often are about these things. But my joke, and again, I'm sorry to offend the men, is I can't tell if it's because I became a woman or I grew up.
Well, in many senses, that's the same thing, you know.
Thank you that you said that. That's exactly right. No, it's not exactly right, but I was intellectually moving in that direction anyway, but I was very far from getting there, and I think that my change in gender sped it up, made it. I got less interested in games, as it were, less interested in prudence only tricks than I was before.
Can I ask you your name? Because it's a very special thing that you've got a chance in your life to change your name.
Well, it's not that special because, you know, nowadays women can choose.
No, everybody can do it,
Donald in Old Irish or in Irish means world ruler. It's a Gaelic name, world ruler. And as far as they can tell, they're not quite sure of this, Deirdre, which is a very old name in Irish, means wanderer. And that struck me, wow, that's perfect. And I was looking in baby books, you know, you're going to choose your child's name. And I came across, and I thought I should keep it as D.
Yeah, because I saw a couple of articles, and I saw the name.
Dorothy, you know, means God's gift in Greek, and that didn't seem right. Diana was my aunt's name, and although she was dead at the time, I don't think she would be honored by that. And Donna, I could go from being Don to Donna. Well, that's kind of cheesy. That's not very nice. So I was down to the D's, I was looking at the D's, and then I came across Deirdre. And then it scored very high on a femininity index. And then this is really spooky. The next day, my sainted mother called and said, your sister and I have been talking about what name you should choose, and we think Deirdre would be a good name.
Oh, wow.
Ooh, spooky, spooky.
That was
settled. Now I'm Deirdre. It?
We have to go to the next clip. It's not a Deirdre, it's a Deborah Tannen, and everything speaks for itself.
Sometimes you get the feeling when you're talking to somebody from the other sex that you're actually talking to somebody from another world. And sometimes I say the reason you get that feeling is that you are. We have these very different rituals that women and men use. And everything that I'm saying today, in a way, is about conversational rituals. We tend to take conversation very literally. We think we mean what we say literally. People often say to me, wouldn't this be a much better world if everyone just said what they mean? And I always answer, we do. We do say what we mean. But we say it by our own conversational style and using the conversational rituals that have come to us to seem self-evidently right. And that's what women and men also do. So coming with these different experiences as children, where the little boys are using language to try and top each other as their kind of game and trying to negotiate their status, and the girls are using language to try to show they're the same and telling secrets and using language to create that friendship, they grow up with very different expectations about the place of language and the way we use conversational rituals to get done what we want done. Very often, walking away from the same conversation, women and men will have different interpretations. And often it's because the women are focusing on the question of connection. Is this way of speaking bringing us closer or putting us farther apart? And very often men are coming to the same conversation with looking at a different axis, different question. Is this conversation putting one of us in a one-up or a one-down position? So the same way of speaking can be interpreted very differently depending on how you're looking at it, whether you're looking at it from the perspective of status or of connection. You know, when I wrote You Just Don't Understand, I had no idea what, of all the anecdotes and insights that I put into the book, people were going to be getting out of it. And really, nothing prepared me for the fact that the one thing that was going to be talked about the most from that whole book was, why don't men like to stop and ask for directions? So let's look at asking directions. Why is it that men are less likely to ask directions? Well, if you think of the experience that you're driving and then you have to stop and you say to somebody, I'm lost and I need your help, can you help me? For many women, you're making a fleeting connection with a stranger, you get where you're going and you haven't lost anything. For many men, you're putting yourself in a one-down position to a stranger. And so it makes sense to avoid the discomfort of being in that one-down position by taking 5 minutes or 10 minutes or 20 minutes or however long it takes to drive around and find it by yourself on your own.
It's funny because she talking about ask for directions. I remember when I agree with her, but when we finally ask for directions, there's also the point of listening, because then when we drive away, my wife will say to me, well, I didn't listen to him. I suppose you listened to him. It's not only talking.
Well, that's because men you are, when you ask directions, ask a man. Don't ask a woman, because this has been shown experimentally. The way women find themselves around the world is through landmarks. Men maybe it's hunting, God knows where it comes from, but men, that is these XY people, tend to think in terms of north, south, east, west, go six blocks, count them.
Yeah.
Whereas women says, go turn at the hairdresser salon or something.
Yeah.
And it's much less informative and often wrong.
Let's go to the talk. You agree with what she's saying?
Absolutely. In fact, her book, I read just as I was transitioning in October of 1995. In France, I was at a conference in France, and on the airplane, I read her book, and it had a tremendous influence on me because she's exactly right. She's spot on, as any thoughtful woman knows. It comes as a surprise to most men.
But did you change your way of speaking and talking because of her?
Partly because of her, but also partly I started to care about the thing she's talking about, namely connection. The game in a female conversation is not always. I mean, sometimes you're trying to show how much socially superior you are to some other woman. But mainly it's about establishing a bond. Whereas among men, it's establishing a hierarchy. And I was less interested in hierarchy than most men. Before, like most men, well, not most men, maybe there's some men who are not this way, but like me before, I didn't know whether some of my colleagues were married or not. I could never remember the name of the secretaries. I didn't know how many children my close friends had. Now, completely spontaneously, as far as I can make out, when some person tells me, oh, sure, this is her second husband, and she had two children by that husband and one by this, and her uncle did such and such, I start filling in a little family tree, which I can reproduce on a quiz, unlike my Dutch vocabulary, which I can't. So there was a kind of a shift. So I'm much better at that kind of stuff than I was. I think I'm still below average for a woman, but now I'm above average for a man.
So did it change your relationships with men also, like in the sense did it improve?
Well, they started treating me like a woman. I remember the first time in Holland. I'm at Rotterdam. I'm a distinguished Tinbergen professor of economy, and I'm in a group of they weren't all Dutch, some of them were Americans, economists speaking English, as you Dutch do, and I was the only woman. Of course, they knew about me, they knew about my past and everything, and we were talking about economics, and I made a point, and they ignored it, and 2 minutes afterwards, George made the identical point. They said, oh, George, this is wonderful. You should do an article on this. Oh, you're great. What a great economist you are. And I said to myself, yes, they're treating me like a woman.
Yeah.
This was the first time and the last time I've enjoyed that experience.
And saying this is also behaving like a woman.
Yeah, indeed it is, complaining about this.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, it's also true, and I've noticed this quite frequently, as women do if they're watching it, the women treat the other women with less, well, go back to that old word that I used before, with less dignity. When a man speaks in a man's voice, alas, I still have pretty much a man's voice, they pay more attention. And that's very irritating because this is our side, the female side, and they're in reinforcing this hierarchy. And I wish they wouldn't, but they do.
And you know your way now around, let's say there's just a restroom. If you walk into a female restroom, I suppose.
Yeah, for a long time I was frightened to do that, but I got over it because I had to go to the bathroom.
And you know what they say? Because somebody has to tell you what they do. I would know what they do. They stand in front of the mirror or they say, hello, how are you? You know?
Here's one thing they do. They talk between the stalls, which men find very shocking.
Yeah.
Men don't talk when they're at the pissoir. They won't think of doing it.
They can't even pee. That's,
they can't even pee. They're terrified that someone will look at their penis or something. They stand there in silence, whereas women talk across the stalls. In fact, they'll talk across an intervening stall. A couple of women will be having a conversation. So that happened. Once I was at a small conference, this was about, some years after I had transitioned. It was a small conference, and I got all involved in the academic talk. And I was with a guy, and I was talking to him, and we had to go to the bathroom. And I walked with him into the men's bathroom. And I noticed the urinal, said, whoops. And he and I were very amused by this because, I'd been in lots of men's bathrooms. I know how to do that, too.
You know what happens there.
I know what happens there.
But you also learn how to talk with somebody in another stall you probably haven't seen.
Yes, you do. Although I'm a little reluctant to do that because, as I mentioned before, I still have this male voice. The operation that was supposed to fix it didn't work. I ought to have done speech therapy alone. And I had a speech therapist in Holland who was marvelous, but she couldn't do much with this instrument. But the problem is that I have a male voice, and then it sounds weird in a women's bathroom to have a male voice. So I don't usually talk much in the ladies' room.
Your voice? It's not a. I don't know if it's.
Well, thank you very
much.
No,
it's not. But it's not a male voice.
Well, it's kind of. I regard it as low and sexy. That's
yeah,
okay
you can
with
work
me.
At certain phone lines in Holland.
Thank you.
We have to go to the last clip.
Okay.
And the last clip you specifically asked for as well, it's from Woodstock, Joan Baez.
Baez. I saw her just the other day here in Chicago. She's lost some of her pizzazz, but she still had it here. She's a great singer.
Yes.
And she's a socialist.
And you still like her?
I still love her. I still love those songs. Joe Hill, The International.
Let's listen to Joe Hill.
Please.
This is an organizing song, and I was happy to find out that after David had been in jail for 2.5 weeks, he already had a very, very good hunger strike going with 42 federal prisoners, none of whom were draft people, so. I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, but Joe, you're 10 years dead. I never died, said he. I never died, said he. Bosses killed you, Joe. They shot you, Joe, says I. Takes more than guns to kill a man, says Joe. I didn't die, says Joe. I didn't die. And standing there, as life, and smiling with his eyes, says Joe, what they can never kill, went on to organize, went on to organize. From San Diego up to died, said he.
so misled in her politics, but such a wonderful spirit.
Thank you very much for being my first female winter guest.
Well, you should do better than that.
No, I'm sorry. These are the facts. It was a pleasure and talking to you. Thank you very much.
I'm going to kiss you because I don't have any female winter guests.
Three times, you know what?
Yeah. Thank you. Good.